local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, good morning, good morning, good morning, and thank you, Peter Herbeck, for that wonderful reflection. Sister Ann Shields was on top of her game this morning, too.
Love our love every single morning, but as we get started, as we continue in the Easter of the octave of Easter, just that spirit of celebration, also that the reminder of what the Lord did for us and what our responsibilities are going forward.
Amen to that.
Well, you know, not only the responsibilities, the opportunities to bring other people into this incredible gift that the Lord has provided for all of us, if we'll just say yes.
It's a great time to do that, especially with all the new catechumens coming into the church over, you know, at the Easter Vigil.
Yeah. Hey, I just said, if we'll just say yes. Say yes.
Hey, yes. That's all. You know, that'd be a good theme for a share-a-thon, wouldn't it? That's coming up here. May 16th is the first day of the share-a-thon, but we've got a great event coming up on April 27th, a Thursday night at the Pinnacle. And, man, we're going to celebrate Mother Angelica's 100th birth anniversary.
Yeah, and 6 days left to register to be a part of that. We sure would love to have you there. We've got, I know the event doesn't take place till April 27th, but we need enough time for food choices, final counts, all those things that happen when you do an event at a facility like the Pinnacle. We're looking forward to seeing everyone there. Thank everyone who has already signed up. Thank the myriad of business sponsors who have been so fabulous about coming forward to be a part of the event and to sponsor the event. But you've got 6 days left, including today, including this weekend. At the end of the day, Monday, we have to cut it off. Mm-hmm. And boy, we would love to have you there. AnnunciationRadio.com to register. AnnunciationRadio.com to register. Or you can always call the office here. If no one answers, just leave a message. We'll get right back with you. 419-868-2966. 419-868-2966. Don't miss it.
Yeah, everybody there will be there, and we want you to be included in that.
Now, I know I'm going to get a call on Tuesday, and when they call on Tuesday, they're going to say, can you fit me in? I said, yeah, I've got a table in the corner. I can get you in, but you have to eat Spam because we didn't get to order your food. Right. And so it's Spam and potato chips for you.
So choice seating and delicious food if you get yourself registered before, you know, by Monday. So again, 419-868-2966, online annunciationradio.com. And it's going to be a who's who of people. I think Wendy's coming. Let's get the news from Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. Today is the perfect day to wear the color blue. Lucas County raising awareness of child abuse prevention. When you wear blue, you take a stand against child abuse and neglect. Last year, more than 1,400 Lucas County kids were victims of child abuse. Lucas County commissioners say they oppose a bill that would expand the private school voucher system to all families in the Buckeye State. Right now, only students from designated public schools can attend a private school. New legislation, known as the Backpack Bill, would eliminate any income or geographic restrictions. Critics say it would take tax dollars away from public education. The TPS Board of Education is expected to talk about the opposition to the bill at a meeting tonight. Ohio's Attorney General working to stop billions of dollars in student loan debt from being forgiven. Attorney General David Yost, along with 19 other states, filed a brief with U.S. Supreme Court arguing that the executive branch does not have unlimited policymaking power. The U.S. Secretary of Education plans to wipe away an estimated $6 billion in student loans. Louisville Metro Police say the gunman who killed five of his co-workers Monday at a downtown bank staged an ambush in the building's lobby to attack responding officers. Body camera video reveals rookie officer Nicholas Wilt was shot in the head within a minute of arriving on scene, while his training officer suffered a gunshot wound to his arm before shooting and killing the suspect. Sources tell CBS News that Republican Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina will announce he's launching an exploratory committee to run for president in 2024. This allows Scott to raise money and is the first step in becoming an official candidate. The International Monetary Fund has revised its world economic outlook for global growth in 2023 down to 2.8%. a decrease of 0.1 percentage point from January's predictions. The group also projects global growth will only reach about 3% per year over the next 5 years, while warning that any more turmoil in the financial industry could hinder growth. In a news conference yesterday, U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen said the outlook is, quote, reasonably bright. Those projections come as Americans are dealing with record-high credit card debt. A new report says it hit $4.8 trillion last month. Credit card interest rates are also soaring now at an average of just over 20%. Soon it could cost more to mail a letter. The U.S. Postal Service wants to raise the price of a first-class stamp another 3 cents to 66 cents. That would be the fourth rate hike in 2 years. If approved, the increase would take effect July 9th. And a pair of Air Jordan 13s worn by Michael Jordan in the 1998 NBA Finals has sold for $2.2 million. It's the most ever paid for a pair of sneakers. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, enjoy this warm spring weather while it lasts. Sunny, mid to upper 70s through Friday. Clouds move in on Saturday, showers possible on Sunday, and turning cooler for the beginning of next week. In the WTOL 11 Newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, Wendy. We appreciate that. 58 degrees, that's our current temperature. And, you know, yesterday we got to 78 degrees.
Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing.
My goodness. And that was, what, 4 or 5 degrees over what was anticipated. Yeah. We're looking at a 74, 75, and we get up to 78. So today we're talking 80. It could be 96.
That's true.
We just don't know.
That's true.
Could go swimming.
Yeah, almost. Haven't opened the pools yet, but, you know, the hose still works. All right, big hour straight ahead. Of course, we got Hump Day Humor coming up.
Yeah, let that water run for a bit before you start getting in that hose water.
Right. We've got Heroes of the Faith, and let's see here. Oh, yeah, Word of the Day straight ahead. Going to love this.
Deacon Dan Brayer a little later.
We'll be right back.
This is Nancy Cook. You are listening to Annunciation Radio, Faith with Frequency.
Join me, Shane Stanfield, and Ron Finn on Annunciation Radio's Faith with Reasons, Wednesday at 4 p.m.
Faith with Reasons, exploring what the church teaches and why. Join us at our next show. Annunciation Radio would like to thank and acknowledge the law firm of Klein, Cook, and Weisenberger, located on Route 20 in Perrysburg, for underwriting a portion of our programming today. The firm specializes in estate planning, with a focus on simplifying estate plans to keep costs down and avoid probate when possible. You may reach Matt Weisenberger at 419-321-6444, online at ccw-law.com. Thank you for supporting Annunciation Radio.
Carry the home missions close to your heart by downloading the free Glen Mary Home Missioners mobile app. Glen Mary brings the Catholic faith to rural parts of Appalachia in the South where it is not effectively present. The free Glen Mary app is a one-stop shop to access daily reflections written by missioners, prayer resources, and information about mission in the United States. The app is available for iPhones and Androids. To download, search Glen Mary in your mobile device's app store or visit glenmary.org/app. That's glenmary.org/app.
What question would you like to ask Bishop Daniel Thomas? Our next Bishop's Corner is coming up, and we want to include your questions about the faith, diocesan issues and events, whatever's on your mind. Be sure to include your first name and parish or location when you send in your question. Use the email link at annunciationradio.com or the Annunciation Radio app, or send an email to bishop@annunciationradio.com. Send in your question and listen for the Bishop's response on Bishop's Corner.
Catholic Radio for the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio. WNOC Bowling Green Toledo. WHRQ Sandusky. WRRO Eden Bryant. WFOT Lexington Mansfield. And WSHB Willard.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
It's Wednesday. It's 8 a.m. now, 8:01, and it's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on this octave of Easter, this Wednesday in the octave of Easter. You know what the difference is between Easter Sunday and Wednesday in the octave of Easter?
Nothing.
It is Easter, baby.
Every day is Easter.
Yeah, and so we all get excited about this big Sunday, and we should, of course, as we've ended the Lenten season and enter into the Easter season. But our church says, look, Easter is not one day. In fact, the octave of Easter lasts all week, and then the season of Easter lasts, what, 50 days. So yeah. We just keep celebrating.
I love it. And, of course, being Wednesday, we've got Hump Day Humor coming up.
Yeah. See, don't bring me down, 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 down. I was being positive.
Yeah, well, you know, we've got some standouts.
Yeah. You standing out, alone in the field? What is that? I'm a standout in my field.
Outstanding in your field.
Yeah. Outstanding in your field. There you go. We told that before.
You know, the thing about the standout jokes
is
it's better if you stand out away from it.
Yeah,
you know
right.
What I mean? But anyway, it's going to be good. But
we digest. What?
Let's hope so.
Yeah.
Word of the day coming up. I love the readings today.
Oh, man, my goodness.
You know, but I say this every day. It's like, this is my favorite reading. And the next day, this is my favorite reading.
Weren't we saying
they're
that?
They're all so good.
We were saying that through Lent.
Yeah.
Because they were so directed toward that season to get us ready for Easter. And now we're in the Easter season, and these are so directed to the Easter season. Yeah. It's just awe-inspiring. It's like the church has wisdom or something. You know?
I know. They're so spot on all the time.
Gotta love it.
Let's see. In addition to Hump Day Humor, of course, we're going to have your Word of the Day reflection, which I really look forward to. And, of course, we'll share the readings for today. But we're also going to have the great deacon is going
to
join us.
Yeah, we look forward to Deacon Dan Brayer a little bit later. A little personal note. So Monday, I jump out of here, drive down to Tennessee.
Yeah.
Yeah, my grandson Judah. Judah,
I'm who's 1 year old,
just
right?
Turned one. Yeah, on the Feast of the Assumption. Annunciation, my bad. Feast of the Annunciation on March the 25th. He turned 1 year old. And then on Easter Sunday, he got an infection, ended up in the hospital, spent a couple nights there. So I ran down there, and he was they got the antibiotics in him, and everything turned yesterday. And he and his parents finally are back home resting in their own beds and getting a little bit of little peace, a little bit of sleep. So thankful for that.
Scary.
So, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, look, you know, they thought they knew what it was going in, and it was they had looked at it and figured that out correctly, but it takes a minute to get it back under control, and so that's what it did. It took about 48 hours, and now he's comfortable in his own crib, they say.
Whew, yeah, pretty scary stuff. So glad that you had a safe trip. That's a long drive.
Yeah. Now, him being comfortable in his own crib and Snoop Dogg being comfortable in his own crib, those are two different things. Yeah.
Right.
I just want to make sure people understand that.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, good. I'm glad to hear that things are looking up.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very happy that, thankful to the Lord that all worked out. Thankful for modern medicine and thankful for those who are trained to administer it.
Well, all I can tell you about today's weather, boring.
Oh, yeah. Boring, just boring, so beautiful, boring. It's boring.
Lots of sunshine and a high near 82 today. How about that?
Now, here's the question, and this is something each person has to face on their own. It's like, you know, when we meet the Lord, it's just us and him. You know, we don't get to bring the rest of us. It's a decision that we have to make. Well, this one is similar to that, not nearly as important, but it is an individual decision, and you're free to make it in whatever direction you think is best, AC or no AC.
Yeah, with 82?
82. It may be time to fire that thing up. Now, who would have thought a week ago that you'd be contemplating turning on the AC?
Right.
But today might be one of those days where you just go, you know, I wasn't really thinking about it. I didn't know that I might be considering it this early in the season. But 82 degrees is kind of at that mark where you might seriously consider turning that AC on.
Well, at least ceiling fans, doors and windows open.
Yeah, yeah.
In your car, you should turn on your AC if you're going above 40 miles per hour. Because there's wind resistance if you lower your windows.
Oh, yeah. Better on the gas mileage to turn on the AC than to roll down your windows. Yeah, that makes sense to me. Mm-hmm. But my car, my house, maybe, I'm not sure about you, but mine is stationary. And so that doesn't apply in any way to the AC in the house. Now, I'm not in a
RV?
RV, yeah. Yeah. So in that case, it's rolling down the windows is only helpful if there's a nice breeze out, or now my favorite is to have the windows open at night, of course.
Ooh, yeah.
And let all that cool air in and then close them up all tightly during the day to keep it there.
I'd rather have the windows up because then you get to hear people mowing their lawns and it gives a real ambience of spring.
Oh, yeah. A lot of ambience in my neighborhood, too. Yeah. Yeah. If that's what we call it, ambience, yeah.
The proof's in the pudding.
I live in Old West End. There are some ambient noises out there that...
Yeah, some of them you don't want to hear. But
might make you duck. Duck, duck, goose. All right. Yeah.
Ambient temperature right now is 59 degrees, 50, by the way, just so you know.
59 already. Yeah. All right.
So there you go.
Love the Old West End, by the way. That was not a crack on the Old West End. Just a statement of reality. It's
pretty much anywhere. Yeah. Be careful about that. Let us pray, shall we?
Let's do it.
Into thy hands, O God, we commend ourselves this day. And all those who are dear to us, let the gift of thy wonderful presence be with us even to the end of the day. Grant that we never lose sight of thee all the day long, but rather praise and beseech thee that our thanks may come to thee again at its close. Amen.
Thank you, and we continue our prayer as we join Parents of Priests in Sarah Club Toledo chapter and pray for our clergy and religious. We pray for vocations and for an increase of faith so as to become a more holy diocese of Toledo. Today we pray for Reverend Charles Denny.
Dear Lord, we pray that the Blessed Mother wrap her mantle around your priests to follow her own words, do whatever he tells you. May your priests have the heart of St. Joseph, Mary's most chaste spouse. May the Blessed Mother's own pierced heart inspire them to embrace all who suffer at the foot of the cross. May your priests be holy, filled with the fire of your love, seeking nothing but your greater glory and the salvation of souls. Amen. St. John Vianney,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you for praying with us this morning and every morning. And as we turn to the Prayer for Priests calendar, we remember to pray for all of our priests. And as we turn to Scripture, we learn what today's word of the day is.
And our word for today on this Wednesday in the octave of Easter, Wednesday, April the 12th, our word for today is astounded. Astounded, our word for today. Our reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple area for the 3 o'clock hour of prayer, and a man crippled from birth was carried and placed at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate, every day to beg for alms from the people who entered the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked for alms. But Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." He paid attention to them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I have neither silver nor gold, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise and walk." Then Peter took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles grew strong. He leaped up, stood, and walked around, and went into the temple with them, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the one who used to sit begging at the Beautiful Gate of the temple, and they were filled with amazement and astonishment at what had happened to him. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm 105, "Rejoice, O hearts that seek the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, invoke his name, make known among the nations his deeds. Sing to him, sing his praise, proclaim all his wondrous deeds. Glory in his holy name, rejoice, O hearts that seek the Lord. Look to the Lord in his strength, seek to serve him constantly. You descendants of Abraham, his servants, sons of Jacob, his chosen ones, he the Lord is our God. Through the earth his judgments prevail. He remembers forever his covenant, which he made binding for 1,000 generations, which he entered into with Abraham and his oath to Isaac.
Our gospel acclamation from Psalm 118. Alleluia, alleluia. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. And they were conversing all about the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looked downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, how our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And because all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described. But him they did not see. And he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are! How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke! Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us when he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?' So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, 'The Lord has truly risen. He has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread."
Astounded, our word for today, our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading. These he shared at his general audience on May the 24th, 2017. Jesus' encounter with those two disciples appears to be completely fortuitous. It seems to be one of those chance meetings that happen in life. The two disciples are walking deep in thought, and a stranger comes up alongside them. It's Jesus, but their eyes are not able to recognize him. And therefore, Jesus begins his therapy of hope. Therapy of hope. What takes place on this road is a therapy of hope. Who administers it? Jesus. First, he asks and listens. Our God is not an intrusive God, even though he knows the reason for the disappointment of those two men. He gives them time to be able to deeply fathom the bitterness which has overcome them. Out of this comes a confession that is a refrain in human existence. We had hoped, but. How much sadness, how many defeats, how many failures there are in the lives of every person. Deep down, we are all a little like those two disciples. How many times we have hoped in our lives, how many times we have felt like we were one step away from happiness, only to find ourselves knocked to the ground, disappointed. But Jesus walks with all people who are discouraged, walking with their heads hung low, and walks with them in a discreet manner. He is able to restore hope. He is able to restore hope. We had hope, but. Just one more thing, Lord. Just one more thing. If I could just have that one more thing. I'm almost there. You've almost made me content. You've almost got me to the point of satisfaction. I believe in you. And I really think if we could just do this one more thing, I'll be there. Isn't that all of us? You know what really strikes me about this reading today? As we're reading through it, this is what struck me. Again, our word for the day, astounded, going back to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple area for the 3 o'clock hour of prayer, and a man crippled from birth was carried and placed at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate every day. Every day he was there begging for alms from the people who entered the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked for alms, but Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." He paid attention to them, expecting something from them. Peter said, "I have neither silver nor gold, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise and walk." I have this question, brothers and sisters. He's at the temple gate every day, it says. He's begging there at the beautiful gate every single day at the temple. Did Jesus go there? What are the odds that Jesus was at that temple? What are the odds that Jesus was at that temple more than once? What are the odds that this man had heard every story about all the healings that Jesus had performed, and then Jesus had made himself present right where he was a few times, and nothing? What are the odds that he thought, "Well, what about me? I've heard about these stories here, there, and everywhere. Why aren't you doing anything for me?" Because the time had not yet come. And I'm sure that as he heard the rest of the story of Jesus, this Jesus that he had heard so many miracles about had now been crucified, he said, "Oh, well, that's the way that goes. There's no authenticity there." That, you know, turned out to be that way. And yet here we see Peter and John coming to that temple gate. They encounter him. And by Jesus, through Jesus' name, by the power of Jesus Christ, the man is healed. And then people see him, they recognize him, they know this man who begs at that gate every day, and the testimony that goes out about this healing then converts, draws interest, creates a curiosity for so many others around this man and around this area. Now was the time for this miraculous healing to take place, not only for the benefit of the beggar, who was blind, but also for the and crippled, but also for the benefit of those who would encounter him, those who would see him. And I said blind, not blind, crippled. And they heal him of this of him being crippled, and he's walking about, and people are encouraged and inspired, and now they see that the power not only existed just in the person of Jesus, but now his followers are moving in the same power as they speak forth his name. And this healing, this transformation of life continues forward. And people are astounded when they see him. Just as the two on the road to Emmaus are astounded when Jesus breaks the bread. But first they went through that time of disappointment. Can you believe it? The women had come to them and said, "Jesus is risen." And their idea was, "Oh, we're leaving." Mm-hmm. For them, it wasn't about that. For them, it was about God, about Jesus redeeming Israel, about setting them free from the Romans. That was their priority. And when that didn't occur, they were done. And it's this, the beginning of that gospel reading is interesting too. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. And they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And then Jesus comes up and asks them what they're talking about. They talk to him about it, and they say that the women had encountered Jesus risen from the dead, and some of their number had gone to check it out. Some of their number had gone to check it out. Not them. They didn't go. And they said some of our number went and checked it out. And yeah, the tomb was empty, but they didn't see Jesus. That was enough for us. We were out of there. And then Jesus encounters them on the road and brings the whole reason, the purpose for his life, the purpose for which he had come. He gives them an understanding of that, that it supersedes everything that they thought or hoped that he might accomplish. And then they believe. And believe me, then they lay down their lives. Then they do all they can to spread this gospel, even to the shedding of their own blood. Because now As Jesus opens their eyes, that astonishment finds a home in them, that it might find a home in us as well, as the Lord works in our lives, and we remove that hope. I have hope, but. Now remove that. Not one more thing needed. The only thing needed is Jesus. Astounded, our word for today.
Yep, and you can just picture the amazement, the astounding feeling that these disciples on the road to Emmaus feel.
Yeah.
Wow.
Look, and they had a love for Jesus, and they're like, Jesus, we're completely with you if you'll do this one thing. Just one thing left. One thing left. You know, and we're... Lord, I love you, but if I could just get this job. Lord, I love you, but if I could just find that spouse. Lord, I love you, but if we could just take care of that problem. But, one more thing. Mm-hmm. Jesus is our one thing. Cling to him. That's all we need.
Yes, and be ready to be astounded.
Amen. Mm.
Thanks, Dave. Great reflection.
Thank you.
And, of course, Deacon Dan Breyer is going to join us about half an hour. And his reflection on today's Word of the Day is coming up. Right now, Wendy's reflection on the news of the day is straight ahead.
Good morning, Wendy.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. Today is the perfect day to wear the color blue. Lucas County raising awareness of child abuse prevention. When you wear blue, you take a stand against child abuse and neglect. Last year, more than 1,400 Lucas County kids were victims of child abuse. Lucas County commissioners say they oppose a bill that would expand the private school voucher system to all families in the Buckeye State. Right now, only students from designated public schools can attend a private school. New legislation, known as the Backpack Bill, would eliminate any income or geographic restrictions. Critics say it would take tax dollars away from public education. The TPS Board of Education is expected to talk about the opposition to the bill at a meeting tonight. Ohio's Attorney General working to stop billions of dollars in student loan debt from being forgiven. Attorney General David Yost, along with 19 other states, filed a brief with U.S. Supreme Court arguing that the executive branch does not have unlimited policymaking power. The U.S. Secretary of Education plans to wipe away an estimated $6 billion in student loans. Louisville Metro Police say the gunman who killed five of his co-workers Monday at a downtown bank staged an ambush in the building's lobby to attack responding officers. Body camera video reveals rookie officer Nicholas Wilt was shot in the head within a minute of arriving on scene, while his training officer suffered a gunshot wound to his arm before shooting and killing the suspect. Sources tell CBS News that Republican Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina will announce he's launching an exploratory committee to run for president in 2024. This allows Scott to raise money and is the first step in becoming an official candidate. The International Monetary Fund has revised its world economic outlook for global growth in 2023 down to 2.8%. A decrease of 0.1 percentage point from January's predictions. The group also projects global growth will only reach about 3% per year over the next 5 years, while warning that any more turmoil in the financial industry could hinder growth. In a news conference yesterday, U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen said the outlook is, quote, reasonably bright. Those projections come as Americans are dealing with record-high credit card debt. A new report says it hit $4.8 trillion last month. Credit card interest rates are also soaring now at an average of just over 20%. Soon it could cost more to mail a letter. The U.S. Postal Service wants to raise the price of a first-class stamp another 3 cents to 66 cents. That would be the fourth rate hike in 2 years. If approved, the increase would take effect July 9th. And a pair of Air Jordan 13s worn by Michael Jordan in the 1998 NBA Finals has sold for $2.2 million. It's the most ever paid for a pair of sneakers. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, enjoy this warm spring weather while it lasts. Sunny, mid to upper 70s through Friday. Clouds move in on Saturday, showers possible on Sunday, and turning cooler for the beginning of next week. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, Wendy. You know, it's sad. There's always going to be somebody who grumbles about the weather It's going to be 82 and sunny. Somebody out there will grumble about that.
Well, look, I have to admit, I try to stay positive, but I thought she, when she said sunny, I thought she was talking to me. And I thought, that's not a proper way to address someone. And then I realized it was the weather, and so.
Oh, yes, okay, good.
No big deal. How about this one? A Sunday school teacher asked the children in her class, if I sold my house and my car, had a big garage sale, and gave all my money to the church, would I get into heaven? No, the children all answered. If I cleaned the church every day, mowed the yard, and kept everything neat and tidy, would I get into heaven? Again, the answer was no. Well, she continued, then how can I get into heaven? A 5-year-old boy shouted out, you gotta be dead.
The wisdom of children.
There you go.
That's one.
A man went to the hospital to visit his friend. He asked his buddy how he was injured. The patient said he'd been advised about a quarrel with his wife. To appease her, he should give her her favorite flower. The patient went on to say, I guess self-rising wasn't the right one.
Yes, indeed. So a man woke up at 5:55 a.m. He opened the front door to get his morning paper and found a nickel next to it.
Mm.
He opened the paper to the sports section and noticed that the fifth horse in the fifth race was named Nickel.
Mm.
He went to the track and he put $555 on the fifth horse in the fifth race.
Yeah.
And watched him finish fifth.
Now, that's pretty funny. That's good. I like that one. How about this one? A retail store manager fought off an armed robber with a labeling gun. Retail store manager fought off an armed robber with a labeling gun.
That's police funny
are now,
already.
Police are now looking for a man with a price on his head.
All right, I'll tell my one.
All right, jump
woman
in there.
From the countryside died. A lovely woman from the countryside died. She found herself outside a beautiful garden with splashing fountains and bright flowers, but she was alone, and the gate was locked. When St. Peter finally came by, the woman said to him, "This is surely a wonderful place. It must be heaven. How do I get in?" "You have to spell a word," said St. Peter. "What word might that be?" "Love," said he. Well, she spelled it all right, was admitted to the into heaven. About a year later, St. Peter asked this woman if she would mind guarding the gates a short while for him. While she was waiting, her husband arrived. "Have you been?" she asked. "Oh, not bad. I married the pretty nurse that took care of you. Then I won the lottery, sold our little cottage, bought a lovely mansion. My wife and I travel around the world. Today I was skiing and broke my neck, and here I am. How do I get in?" "You have to spell a word." "What word is that?" "Czechoslovakia." I don't like his chances.
Yes.
I like that one. Yes. Rabbits jump and live 8 years. Dogs run and they live 16 years. Turtles do nothing and live 150 years. Today I'm doing nothing.
Yeah, there you go.
Exercise. I finally figured out why I'm having a problem with this. I've been trying to lose a little weight. Exercise. I thought they said extra fries. It's been working against me.
Wow. And the Lord said unto John, "Come forth and you will receive eternal life." But John came fifth and won a toaster.
Come forth. I like that. My nephew's name is Jack. My nephew's name is Jack. I'll never greet him in an airport again. Hi, Jack.
Don't do that. Okay, I broke my finger last week.
Yeah?
On the other hand, I'm okay.
I like that.
Women only call me ugly until they find out how much money I make. Then they call me ugly and poor.
Mm-hmm. I like that. There how about go. Some waking up jokes? I never thought I'd be the type of person who would one day get up early in the morning to exercise. And I was right. My morning alarm is clearly jealous of my amazing relationship with my bed. Yeah, that's true.
That's true.
I would be a morning person, and this one is true. I would be a morning person if morning happened around 1 p.m.
Yeah, there you go. I can relate to that. All right, so the sign in the supermarket says manager special. I thought it odd because he looked like an average guy to me.
Oh, geez. There you go. Every day at breakfast, I announce... No, listen. Hold on. This one you might be a takeaway with you. Just pay attention for just a second. Right. Every day at breakfast, I announce that I'm going for a jog, and then I don't. Every day at breakfast, I announce that I'm going for a jog, and then I don't. It's my longest running joke of the year. It's my longest running joke of the year. And then I'm going to bring mine home with one more that I really thought would be... And I want to thank Alice for this. Alice gave me a few of these jokes. And this one I think is another keeper or taker. I'm not sure which way you go with that. But Where do they make average things? Where do they make average things?
I don't know.
The Satisfactory.
Oh, the Satisfactory.
Where do they make average things? At the Satisfactory. And so thank you, Alice. Thanks for that joke and a couple of the others.
And a couple from the dad joke calendar. What does a baby computer call its father?
I don't know.
Data.
That's cute.
Let's see. You can't run through a campsite. You can only ran because it's past tense.
Tense.
All right, what do you call it when one bull spies on another bull?
I don't know.
A stake out.
Oh, no.
My friend brought me a telekinetic abacus for my birthday. It wasn't my favorite present, but it's the thought that counts. And what does a cloud do when it gets an itch?
I don't know.
Finds the nearest skyscraper.
Ooh, there you go. Okay, I like it.
I got two others. Why did the Oreo go to the dentist?
I don't know.
It lost its filling.
Ooh, that's cute.
And why did the Scarecrow get an award?
Because he was outstanding in his field. We've been telling these for a while.
It's almost a contest of what have you heard before.
We've heard it all before. Yeah. We've told most of it.
There you go. Hey, I think there were some takeaways there. So
yeah, please, Marian, take these away.
Yeah, take them away. Take them away. Calgon, take me away.
All right. You are officially released from Hump Day Humor on this Wednesday here on Morning Offering.
The effects of abortion are greater than most people realize. It isolates, hurts families, brings about fear, sadness, and grief. It does not need to separate you from God. If you or someone you know is hurting after an abortion, please reach out to Project Rachel at 419-260-5811 or by going to hopeafterabortion.org. Nothing is too great for God's mercy. Project Rachel is here to offer confidential help on your journey to healing.
Time is running out for you to reserve your spot for the Annunciation Radio 100th Anniversary of the Birth of Mother Angelica event. Coming up on April 27th at the Pinnacle. The deadline for your reservation is Monday. Make sure you go to AnnunciationRadio.com, click the RSVP button, tell us how many are coming in your party and what your meal choices are. You don't want to miss this event. The deadline is Monday. AnnunciationRadio.com. RSVP today.
It's time for Annunciation Radio's 2023 spring campaign. Our theme is Say Yes. We're celebrating the 100th anniversary of the birth of Mother Angelica and giving thanks that she said yes. We're having a big dinner and a birthday party on Thursday, April the 27th at the Pinnacle in Maumee. Our special guest speakers are Bishop Thomas, as well as Father Joseph Wolf and Jack Williams from EWTN. To register, visit us at AnnunciationRadio.com or call 419-868-2966. If you recently received our newsletter, you also got a copy of my new book, Faith Over Fear, Lessons from My Life with Mother Angelica, which highlights my own personal experiences with her and how those interactions set the course for my life. I can't wait to celebrate Mother Angelica's extraordinary life with you. Again, for more information or to register, visit us at AnnunciationRadio.com or call 419-868-2966.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Yes, so much to get to on this Wednesday, and we can't wait to get there, but I want to pass this along to you. This is a real news.
Yeah.
Okay, you ready for this?
Yeah.
And it kind of, it almost falls in place right behind Hump Day Humor, but it's out of Harrisonville, Missouri, from the Associated Press. A 78-year-old woman with two past bank robbery convictions.
78-year-old woman with two bank...
Yeah, she faces new charges after authorities allege she handed the teller a note that said, "I didn't mean to scare you during a recent Missouri heist." She is jailed, Bonnie Gooch, on a $25,000 bond. She was charged with a count of stealing or attempting to steal from a financial institution in the holdup this past Wednesday in Pleasant Hill.
Oh, my goodness.
So a week ago today, no attorney listed for her, and... She was also convicted of robbing a California bank in 1977 and one in Kansas City in a suburb there in 2020, and her probation in the second heist ended in November of 2021. So here she goes again. Court documents filed in Cass County said in the latest case, the robbery note demanded 13,000 small bills, adding, "Thank you, sorry, I didn't mean to scare you."
Oh, my goodness. So,
surveillance video caught the whole thing, and she was pulled over less than 2 miles away. She smelled strongly of alcohol when officers stopped her. Imagine that. Yeah. So who knows where her next heist will be? I don't know. But 78-year-old bank robber.
Bonnie Gooch, right? Bonnie Gooch. And what we're not aware of yet, we're waiting for a statement from her husband, Clyde. Hey, how about this one? And because you said that, normally we shut the door on Hump Day Humor, but because you told that story, you opened the door, and so I get to walk through too.
Okay.
And this one goes with Bonnie. What do prisoners use to call each other?
Gotta be a cell phone, right?
Cell phone. There you go. So, very cute. All right.
Sorry I ruined that. I apologize.
Thank you. No problem. I'm accustomed to such things. Anyway,
I would think so.
But Bonnie, look, you have to say, we don't want her to continue to rob banks, but she does have manners about it, you know?
So, that's true.
Gotta love that.
I don't want to scare you, but give me your money.
All right. Are we ready? Oh, we've got, today is April 12th. April 12th.
April 12th already?
Now, right now, this April 12th is in the octave of Easter. Not always so, but always something. There must have been something significant that has happened on
today
April 12th.
In history.
Has to be.
I take way too long to do the setup for today in history.
Not at all.
Should just say today in history.
All.
So the lady's name was Gooch.
Yeah.
So Gooch was a mooch.
Yeah.
Gooch,
yeah.
Mooch on society, unfortunately. All right.
Now we have to officially close the door on Hump Day Humor.
Yeah, there we go. It's done. It wasn't funny while it was happening.
Yes, it's true. On April 12th, 1861, the Civil War began. Confederate forces opened fire on Fort Sumter in South Carolina. That's one place I want to visit, Fort Sumter. It's pretty small, but it has historical significance. A patent today in 1892 for the first portable typewriter was issued in the United States, but it didn't help with my typos.
Yeah.
Still got plenty of those. And on this date in 1945, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt died of a cerebral hemorrhage in Warm Springs, Georgia at the age of 63, succeeded by Vice President Harry S. Truman. And two birthdays today, the Ball State alum David Letterman.
Oh,
76 years old today.
Oh, my goodness.
And Vince Gill, 66, country music singer.
Now, going back to President Roosevelt, who would have thought, I would have thought he'd been like 90.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he was president for a very long, almost 12 years, right? He was 8, 10, 10 yeah, 11,
polio.
12 years. And he dies at 63.
Yeah.
But I thought he was, if they just asked me, how old was President Roosevelt when he died? I'd probably say like 75, 76, but 63, I never would have guessed that.
I never would have guessed that either. I mean, obviously, as we know, there's health problems. He had polio and some other health problems. And why was he in Warm Springs, Georgia?
It sounds like a nice place to visit.
Yeah, right.
It's warm.
Hey, I got a little, I bet you didn't
well,
know
before,
that.
Well, before you get to that, I know Wendy was saying in the news that you wear blue today, right?
Yeah, right.
But today is International Day of Pink.
Oh.
So we have a contrast.
Maybe they just didn't want to offend any of the, either of the established genders. So they did the blue and the pink.
I don't have any pink in, October's Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and I don't have any pink.
Well,
and,
but your birthday's coming up at some point.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's after. so I'm going to have to ask my wife for an early birthday.
There you go. And I got a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. How about this one? Competitive art used to be in the Olympics. This is from Shutterstock.
Competitive art?
Between, 1912 and 1948, the Olympic Games awarded medals in sculpture, music, painting, and architecture, according to the Smithsonian magazine. After a heated debate in the post-war years, the competitions were scrapped. So after a heated debate, like, did the architects get in a fight with the sculptors or sculptors?
Well, I often get them confused, artists with being athletic.
Yeah, stop signs used to be yellow. How about this? In 1922, the American Association of State Highway Officials met to determine a standard design for stop signs, and that's where they decided on the color yellow. Yellow. Yes, according to Business Insider, stop signs were yellow because they thought they would grab drivers' attention. They'd also considered red, but there was no dye available at the time that wouldn't eventually fade. By 1954, however, sign makers had access to fade-resistant porcelain enamel and could finally start making stop signs in the color red that we all become so accustomed to now. I wouldn't, like, I would see yellow, I would slow down, but I wouldn't stop.
Right.
You know, that's caution. That's not stop. So, yeah. So
well,
I'm glad they
blue.
Went with red.
In Europe, they have stop signs. Some European countries are blue.
Oh, yeah, I've seen the blue. Mm. How about this one? Now, I've covered this before, but producer Tim has a connection to this. Green eggs and ham started as a bet. So if you've listened to me every show for the last 3.5 years, you've heard this, and so I don't mean to bore you. But the Dr. Seuss classic grew out of a bet with the editor that he could not create a book using 50 words or fewer. And that's why he wrote the book Green Eggs and Ham. He used 50 words or fewer. And he and so the guy had to pay him $50. So there was another bet on an item that might be of interest.
Yeah, as a spinoff from that, Toby Keith was in the bus with his with the people he tours with, and one of them said, "Hey, I bet you can't make a bet of anything in this RV or whatever they're traveling in." And said, "Okay, well, I'll take up that bet." So Toby says that, and so he picked up a red Solo cup. And that's why we get the hit for Toby Keith, Red Solo Cup.
Oh, my goodness.
So he was challenged on the bus to write a song about whatever object.
Yeah, whatever they picked up.
And it was the Red Solo Cup. Red Solo Cup.
That's a great karaoke song.
I've never heard that song before.
Trying to think all the things that he could have picked up.
Yeah, right. You
know, a stapler.
I'm glad that...
Red Solo Cup was probably least offensive among them. So there we go. Love
Your
that.
Sickness bag.
Yeah. So there's a little... I bet you didn't know that. I know I did with a little added extra. And now Heroes of the Faith.
Moscati. St. Joseph Moscati.
Oh, no, this is one, of the faith a name I'm familiar with.
Oh, are you good? Okay. Yeah. Also known as Giuseppe Mario Carolo Alphonse Moscati.
I know him as the first name.
Yeah. April 12th is his memorial. He was the seventh of nine children born to a prominent family, the son of Francisco Moscati, who was a lawyer and a magistrate, who served as an altar server whenever possible, and Rosa de Luca del Marchi de Rosetto. That's his mother. Her family was Italian nobility. So born into that. And then Giuseppe's family moved to Naples, Italy, when the boy was 4 years old. He made his first communion at 8, confirmed at 10. Now, he worked and served as an administrator of a hospital for the incurable while continuing to do his study and do some medical research. He was a member of the Royal Academy of Surgical Medicine, and was the first to experiment with the use of insulin for diabetics. He tried to enlist in the World War I, but was refused and ran a hospital instead for the wounded. He personally treated almost 3,000 soldiers. He was the first modern physician to be canonized.
Yeah.
So he could sometimes diagnose a patient's illness and prescribe without even seeing the patient.
Wow.
Pretty amazing. So he definitely had a gift. He died around 3 p.m. on April 12, 1927, of a stroke in his office while taking a break between patients. Canonized by John Paul II in 1987.
EWTN has a fabulous movie on St. Joseph Moscati. So
awesome.
Just look
That's
it up.
Awesome, yeah.
It's definitely worth the watch.
It's our hero. Welcome to Catechism for Today with Father Nicholas Weibel. Lessons for daily life from the Catechism of the Catholic Church.
The parents were at a school meeting the different teachers and rushing from one teacher to the other. And then the principal made an announcement. All parents are asked to assemble in the auditorium to hear the school band play some Mozart. Don't worry, it won't take too long. So all the parents had been seated, the band director welcomed everyone. Very careful to point out, Mozart piece would only take 2 minutes. With that, the band played, parents applauded, moved on to the next event scheduled for the night. One parent stopped to thank the music director for the evening performance. The director thanked the parent, but he went on to say, "I would have prepared a longer program, but when you look out and see all those tight-lipped parents looking at their watches, positioning themselves to be nearest to the exit, I just lose heart and offer a 2-minute selection. I just wonder to myself, if we don't have time for our children to play Mozart, what do we have time for?" And what does the Catechism say about this? Paragraph 3. Those who with God's help have welcomed Christ's call and freely responded to it are urged on by love of Christ to proclaim the good news everywhere in the world. This treasure received from the apostles has been faithfully guarded by their successors, as Christ's faithful are called to hand it on from generation to generation by professing the faith, by living it in fraternal sharing, and by celebrating it in liturgy and in prayer. In paragraph 2031, the moral life is spiritual worship. We present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, within the body of Christ that we form and in communion with the offering of His Eucharist. If today you hear His voice, harden not your hearts.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And just so you can keep us straight, if you're a new listener to Morning Offering, with Ron and Dave, one of us is Ron and one of us is Dave, and generally we sit at opposite ends of the studio.
Well, I'm often referred to as that guy that's on the radio with Ron.
And I like that.
I'm very comfortable with that. They say, I meet them and they say, oh, so you're the guy that's on with him. Yeah.
See, I get the same thing. They say, oh, you're the one that does that show with Dave.
Oh, yeah. From my mother only. Yeah.
Well, yeah. That's how it works, I guess.
The only one who has ever said that ever. Good morning to you, Ron. Hey, let me ask you this big question.
It's a beautiful day today.
Yeah.
Lots of sunshine in the offing. 82, I think, for a high today.
Now, I asked a question, but I didn't get the answer earlier. Will you turn on the AC today?
No.
You and Donna? No.
I refuse.
You'll just push through today, mm-hmm. because it's just too early in the season to mm-hmm. be turning on air conditioning.
Can't do it.
I have a follow-up question. What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but Marvin Gaye sounds better asking that question than you.
He really does. No, I'm sorry. You just can't deny that. I'm not even going to argue that point.
Well, there's a lot of stuff going on, and let's start with Saturday, the Young Adult Revival Retreat Day at Sylvania Franciscan Mother House. That's on Convent Boulevard in Sylvania. National Eucharistic preacher Reverend Stephen Hayes will be leading a Eucharistic presentation. There'll be breakout sessions, reconciliation, and Mass at 5 p.m. with Bishop Thomas, and then dinner and a Eucharistic talk in adoration and benediction. It all starts at 1 o'clock Saturday out there in Sylvania at the Mother House, and you can register at eventbrite.com. Two events on April 19th with Missy Martinez-Stone, CEO of Reprotection, and Peter Range, CEO of Ohio Right to Life here in Northwest Ohio. The Lunch for Life at TDC Investments starts at from noon to 1. That's on Arrowhead Drive in Maumee. And then she'll be at Awakened Catholic Studios for Fight for Life, taking place from 7 to 8:30 p.m. And the Awakened Catholic Studios in Bowling Green there on North Main Street at the Woodland Mall. Tickets for both of those events with Missy Martinez-Stone and Peter Range are available through eventbrite.com. And then, the Andrew Dinner is coming up on Wednesday, a week from today. Andrew Dinner for High School and College Men, and that's going to be at Corpus Christi University Parish, Bishop Daniel Thomas and Father Phil Smith. You can register for free by calling the diocesan office, participants should be accompanied by their parish priest. And, of course, we're really looking forward to Mother Angelica's birthday party.
April 27th, that's coming right up at the Pinnacle, Thursday evening from 6 to 8:30. We'll have Father Joseph Mary Wolf from EWTN, also Jack Williams, EWTN Radio General Manager, and Bishop Thomas all speaking at that event. If you haven't registered, one, why haven't you? And then two, go ahead and do that now, AnnunciationRadio.com. AnnunciationRadio.com or call the office 419-868-2966.
And everything has a cutoff, and for this Monday,
we're coming up
is the last day to get your RSVP in and get your dinner selection made.
Yeah.
So make sure you go to the website, AnnunciationRadio.com, or call in here, and we'll make sure that we reserve a spot for you and yours. And, tickets just reserve your spot. Tell us what you want to eat because we have dinner choices there,
good
too.
Good food and a giant cake. That's what's waiting for you.
Word of the Day coming up with Deacon Dan Breyer. And, man, what great readings today. Can't wait to hear his take on all of that. Fire is alive.
And our word for today on this Wednesday in the octave of Easter, Wednesday, April the 12th, our word for today, astounded. Astounded, our word for today here to talk about it is Deacon Dan Brer. Happy Easter, Deacon Dan Brer. It's good to be with you today. Can't wait to hear your thoughts on our readings for today and our word for today as we get together for the first time, having you back since Easter season has begun.
Well, Ron and Dave, happy Easter. How wonderful to have celebrated all of the Easter sacraments and bringing all of these elect into the church. Mm. It's certainly an exciting time. I love the octaves of Easter. I tell my RCIA elect and candidates that it's Groundhog Day.
Mm.
You know, every morning when you wake up during the octaves of Easter is celebrating Easter all over again.
I
the exact same liturgy of the hours prayers. Every day when you wake up, it's Easter all over again.
Mm. Love that.
So, yeah, it's a great season.
Well, I love that, too.
So the word today, astounded, actually appears in the gospel, although there is a related word, which is astonished, that appears in the first reading as well. So the gospel taken from Luke chapter 24 is that famous story of the walk to Emmaus. And, you know, so much has been said and written and preached about that reading for years and years and years because it's so rich. In fact, at first glance, I think when you read that story, it almost feels more like a story from John's gospel than Luke's in terms of its depth and symbolism and so forth. But in a nutshell, the gospel is about that walk to Emmaus. So there are two disciples that are walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and they're discussing what happened back in Jerusalem with this death and supposed resurrection of Jesus, and they don't understand it. And suddenly Jesus kind of appears in their midst, and he's walking along with them, and they start discussing the whole thing. And he says, what are you talking about, and what sort of things happened back there? And they said to him, I can't believe you don't know, you haven't heard this story. And so they start telling the story of Jesus. He was a mighty prophet, he died, he was crucified. But then they say that the women discovered that the tomb was empty, and now we hear this vision of angels said that he's risen from the dead. And that they were astounded when the women had seen that the tomb was empty. And so Jesus finally, after listening to some of this, says to them, how foolish you are in missing the point. And he starts explaining to them the Old Testament, and he talks about the prophecies of the Old Testament, how that was going to play out, and helps them to understand that the Old Testament prophecies had all been about Jesus, about this person who had died. Now, oddly enough, as this conversation goes on and he's explaining the Old Testament and so forth, they still don't know who he is.
Mm.
You know, as far as they're concerned, this is just some stranger they met on the road. I'm reminded as Jesus is explaining that about St. Augustine, that famous line where Augustine said that what is concealed in the Old Testament is revealed in the New Testament. You know, and that's what Jesus is trying to explain to them here in this conversation. This was concealed, but now it has actually come to fruition. This resurrection has actually taken place at this time. And so these men are so fascinated with him, they invite him to stay with them. And whenever I hear that, I think of at Gethsemane Abbey in Kentucky, and at Trappist Monastery, during the Easter season, every day at mid-afternoon prayer, they sing a verse, "Stay with us, Lord, alleluia. Evening draws near, alleluia." And that's taken directly from Luke. It's right out of that gospel reading. It's just beautiful how they do that. So they have dinner with him. And as they're having dinner, what does Jesus do? He breaks the bread, and suddenly their eyes are open. My goodness, now we get it. We know who we're with here. And then he vanishes from their sight, it says, at that point. So it took them until they actually sat at the table to figure this out. And so theologians have done a lot of writing over the years about, like, why didn't they recognize him in the first place? And probably, most likely, because his resurrected body would not have looked exactly the same as his human body that he had before the resurrection. We know, for example, that a resurrected body can walk through walls. And it can vanish from their sight and so forth. And so Jesus was able to enter the upper room without opening the door, even though it was locked, because there's, in my RCIA, again, they'll ask about that and say, how can you walk through a wall? And I'll say, well, think of it this way. Can you walk through a cloud? Like if it's foggy outside, you can walk right through the fog. You know, and so if our bodies can walk through fog, surely our resurrected body can walk through a wall. But, you know, but they didn't recognize him. They didn't know who he was until he broke the bread. And therein lies, I think, a really neat analogy for this reading. And that is that the story of Emmaus is kind of symbolic of the Mass itself. It's like the celebration of Holy Mass. Think about it. At the beginning of the story, the first thing they do is they talk about the Word, about the Gospels, or really about the Old Testament. And then comes the homily. So Jesus is preaching to them, and he's connecting the Old Testament to what's happening today. And then they sit down at the table, and they break bread, and they celebrate the Eucharist. You know, and then Jesus moves on, and then these men are left to talk about it, to go forth and spread the Word. That's exactly what we do at Mass. There's a Amen. Liturgy of the Word, a homily, a liturgy of the Eucharist, and then we go out to share the Word. You know, so it's this beautiful, there's so much symbolism there. And it connects back to the first reading, too, because in the first reading from Acts, Peter heals a crippled man. And it says that the people were astonished by the miracle, and the men were astounded by the news of the resurrection and the gospel. So there's this theme as we go through the octave of Easter about being astonished, astounded, amazed at what has happened in Jerusalem, what is happening at Emmaus. And I think the takeaway for me for both of these readings, and maybe the whole octave of Easter, is that sometimes we just take too much granted for granted in this world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that things kind of happen, and we seem to be in a society where it just takes so much for us to be amazed or astonished anymore, and that maybe if we take a really close look at the world that we live in, the people that we encounter, the beauty of the earth itself, and the things that God gives us every day, we would be more astounded more often of the things that God is giving us. And I think this Easter season gives us a chance to be able to look at that and really notice God in our presence.
Mm. Well, that really makes you think.
Yeah. Mm. Love that, Deacon Dan. And look, I look at this and I think these two disciples, which means they followed the Lord, listened to his preaching, followed him all the way through, and then are hearing whispers about him being resurrected, and their idea is to leave. And I'm thinking, isn't that enough for you? How much are you looking for? And then I'm reminded, I'm kind of like that.
Yeah, that's yet another theme of the reading. They're not going from Emmaus into Jerusalem to explore this. They're leaving Jerusalem.
Yeah.
You know, what's the deal here? We do the same thing. We miss it, and we walk away from it.
Thank you, Deacon. It's great to say Thank Alleluia you. Once again, isn't it?
Absolutely.